All right, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Exciting day for Miami Athletics as we formally introduce our new women's basketball coach, Tricia Cullop. But first, we're going to get started with some remarks from our Vice President and Director of Athletics, Dan Radakovich. Dan.
Carter, thank you, and good afternoon, everybody. I really appreciate you all taking a few minutes to join us here today. When Katie Meyer decided to step down after 19 years as our head women's basketball coach and become a part of our administrative team, we immediately launched a national search for her replacement. We had a great search. We had an incredible amount of national interest, and I want to thank some people here, Joe Echeverria, Rudy Fernandez, Rochelle Paul, Brian Baptiste, for their assistance in the search, as well as our partners with Turnkey, a national search firm, and specifically Jocelyn Gates, who works with Turnkey. Our goal was not only to find a coach with proven success on the court, but someone who leads by example and recruits at a high level, emphasizes academics, prepares their student athletes for life after basketball, and energizes a fan base. That's a pretty long list. And I will tell you, we found that coach when we spoke with Tricia Cullop. Tricia's record over 24 years as the head coach at Toledo and Evansville speaks for itself. 476 career wins, 10 20-win seasons, 12 postseason berths, 6 regular season conference championships, and 7 conference coach of the year honors. In her last 3 years at Toledo, she averaged 28 wins a year and went 43-4 at home. But as we got to know Tricia more during the interview process, it was how she built the program that really stood out. She recruited well, she developed well, she scheduled tough, her players performed in the classroom and connected with the community. She engaged the students, faculty, alumni, donors, and media to create a game day atmosphere second to none. In short, she continually delivered on the motto that drives her: invest, improve, and inspire. Tricia has made an impact everywhere she's been, and I have no doubt she will continue to do that at the University of Miami. Tricia sees the potential here, the location, the resources, the conference, and the support. She's excited about building the very solid foundation of Miami women's basketball, and we are excited to officially welcome her to Coral Gables. Ladies and gentlemen, head women's basketball coach Tricia Cullop.
I'm extremely honored to be chosen to lead the women's basketball program at the University of Miami. This is a world-class education. This program has a winning tradition, a talented team that I can't wait to coach. It's a beautiful campus. Every turn I make as I make my way around campus, I'm so impressed with what I see. It's a top-notch facility that we're working in, not only the offices, the locker room, the arena. We're going to be playing in an unbelievable conference that is so competitive but yet inspiring. And it's in a wonderful location. I got to tell you, when Dan asked me all the reasons I was interested, I listed those, and then I said 284 days of sun a year, and you had me. So I have the utmost respect for Katie Meyer, and I want to make sure that, you know, everyone realizes that we're not here to blow this thing up. She did an amazing job in her tenure building this program into something really special nationally. And our job is to pick up the reins and try to not only maintain that, but to take it to another level. You know, it won't be easy to follow in her footsteps because of the respect that we do have for her. But I will say we're going to certainly pull up our bootstraps and try because we are so excited to be here. And I also want to acknowledge two people that laid the foundation for that program, and that's my former college coach, Lynn Dunn, as well as Fern Labate, who stopped by my office yesterday. And we have so much respect for what they did to build this program from the ground up, and also for Katie for what she's done in her long tenure. I want to thank President Julio Frank, CEO Joe Echeverria, Executive VP Rudy Fernandez, Senior Deputy Director Brian Baptiste, Deputy Director, and Deputy Athletics Director and Senior Women's Administrator Rochelle Paul, as well as our Athletic Director Dan Radakovich. When I ask people about the leadership at Miami, they said, jump in, because you're going to be surrounded by amazing people. And in my decision-making my whole career, it's not been about the facilities, it's not been about the campus, it's been about the people that I will surround myself by. And you don't win with those other things, you win with people. And I knew I would be in great hands in this department. I want to thank our women's basketball supporters, some of them I had a chance to meet and honor to meet before we opened up today. And, I also want to thank the Canes Connection for all they're doing in the NIL space. We are so grateful for the work they're doing to keep us competitive. 16 years ago, Mike O'Brien hired me to lead one of the best mid-major programs in the country. And I'm extremely grateful to Mike for giving me that opportunity, as well as our president, Dr. Gregory Postal, and our current athletic director, Brian Blair. It was an amazing opportunity, and I got the privilege of enjoying many successful seasons and enjoyable seasons there. I appreciated how that community wrapped its arm around our program, and I fully expect that to happen here. And so I also want to just say that we are going to do everything in our power to build this fan base. And so if you can point me in the right direction to get more people there, do it. Because after we finish up solidifying our team, recruiting, and maybe finding a house, I will be encouraging anybody and everybody to come to our games. I'm excited to announce that we do have some key members of our staff here. We will be retaining, and we're excited that they're staying, Fitzroy Anthony. He has done a fantastic job, and a big reason. When I took the job, I got in a car and drove over to the Final Four, not for the games, but for him. I thought it was important that for our continuity and for his skill set that we needed him. And so we met. He didn't know me. I think I maybe alerted or scared him just a little bit because I was so intent on keeping him. But after we had a chance to talk, it was so glad to hear that he was willing to stay and help us continue what he started. And along with that, Lynette, we are so glad that Lynette Hall and Margie Gill are going to be joining us as well. They have... Go ahead. They have helped us accelerate our recruiting efforts and hit the ground running. And when you're making a change like this, that is so integral to our success. We would be many weeks behind if those three hadn't decided to help us and stay here. And so we are grateful for that. I'm also thrilled to bring two members of my former staff here with me, because they are a big reason why we had three championships in a row and why I have less gray hair. Because Jesse Ivey, stand up, Jesse, and then Daniel Page. One thing you'll learn about my hires is they've got to be amazing humans first. They've got to be high character people. They've got to work extremely hard. They've got to stand for the right things, and then they better know basketball. And those two have combined with these three to already make an outstanding staff. And we're not done yet. We've got a few more pieces to fill. But I do think that had to happen first. We had to have the foundation in place. Last year's Miami team should have been the NCAA tournament. It was razor thin. You know, you could make an argument either way. From a coach's perspective, I will tell you they should have been in. And one thing I will say is that we return a strong nucleus, and our goal is not just to be barely in, but to be all the way in and to make sure that we're in and making some noise. So we're going to be building, and we're going to be working tirelessly to put together an up-tempo team that you're going to enjoy running, or their running style. You're going to enjoy a stingy defense and continue all the work that Fitz has put in with this defense. I really want this team to frustrate teams defensively, not only with a press but in the half court, to put together an offense that's fun to watch, where we share the ball for the best shot, not just any shot, that we push the ball intently because we're in amazing shape, and that we wear teams out. So finally, I just want to say that, you know, this team, we're going to strive relentlessly to make you proud of us in the classroom, on the court, and in the community. And I'm going to need all of your help to make sure that community part happens. Because as we get to know everyone, we want to get our kids out even more. The more they meet our kids, you see what's happening nationally with women's basketball, and we want this program to catch hold of it too as well. So thank you so much for being here today. I can't tell you how honored I am to be your head coach, and go Canes. Nice to meet you.
I'm supposed to say hello from Christine Brennan. And also from
love Christine Brennan.
And Pete Holterman, whom you worked with at
Exactly. I did. Long time.
So those are two hellos to welcome you. Piggybacking on what you just said about what's happening nationally, it really does seem to be a tipping point right now with what just happened this week, you know, women's tournament outdrawing events and all that. How do you think that you can seize on that and try to increase the fan base here? It's a difficult market. It's not like the Midwest that has a strong tradition in women's sports. It really doesn't down here. So what do you think you can do? What can you bring? I know that that's one of your missions, one of your specialties is increasing the fan base. What do you think you can do? Have you given that any thought? I know you've been busy the last few weeks.
Just a little bit. You know, when I was at Evansville, there were about 300 fans in the stands when I started. And when I left, there were 1,500. That doesn't seem like a lot until I tell you there's only 2,400 students in the whole school. When I came to Toledo, there were 1,500 fans in the stands. The program had been through 5 losing seasons, and we finished up with 4,500 fans in the stands. It doesn't happen overnight. I don't expect a blink of an eye and just tell you I want it and it happened. We're going to have to roll up our sleeves, and we're going to have to begin get out in the community and establish relationships. People don't come because of a billboard or an advertisement. They come because something in their heart draws them to come to the game. So my job is to get our kids out. I'm not going to wear them out and make them make their academics suffer, but there's a lot of opportunities in the summertime when they're here to get them out to meet with different groups, different basketball clubs, go to schools and read. Make sure that people know that if we want them to care about our program, that we care too about this community and we're willing to roll up our sleeves. When I took the job at Toledo, I'd never turned down a speaking engagement. And it wasn't because I enjoy speaking. It was because I knew that if people could learn more about our program, that we could draw them in. And little by little, whether it was a group of 12 or a group of 5,000 that I spoke to, we got them there. And I think once we got them in a game, we got them hooked. But it's all on us too. When they come, they need to be inspired. It needs to be a style of basketball that they enjoy. And so we're gonna do our part. Obviously winning helps, but so does building relationships. And that's what we gotta roll up our sleeves and do. Thank you. Thank you.
She's looking forward to those 284 days. Part of life at a mid-major is every time when you get things rolling, your name comes up for jobs. It's life at a mid-major.
Whether you're in them or not.
Whether it's real or not.
Yeah.
Your name has been on a lot of this over the years.
Yeah. Well, first I'll say what kept me there. Unbelievable people, and I had the best mid-major job in the country. And I could be picky. And I didn't want to just go just anywhere. I wanted to go where there were unbelievable people in the administration, that I was set up for success. This was an unbelievable situation because Katie did such a great job, and her staff. And so the cupboard's not bare. So it's rare that you can come into a program that has all these things, and it didn't go through a losing season to have to make the change. And so I was, when the job came open, I was like, that is such an incredible opportunity. And then when I came to visit, I was blown away. When I got to see campus and when I got to learn about what an amazing education that it is and meet all the integral people that are involved with the program. So for me, it was opportunity to be successful and be supported and be at a place where they actually care about women's basketball. They don't just say it, they care. And they want this program to be successful. I want to be supported in that way. And that's why it was the right time. And who can't sell this? I mean, anytime I call recruits, all I have to do is walk outside and FaceTime. or send them a couple pictures. I mean, this is an unbelievable place. College kids don't have much free time. And when they do, if they can go to the beach, or they can go to a soccer game, or a professional baseball game, or a professional basketball game. We have so many things at our fingertips here that their college experience can be unbelievable. Yeah. Go ahead.
I know what Coach Dunn obviously means to you.
Yeah.
Does it feel like this is somewhat was predestined a little bit?
Well, it is a full circle moment. I saw her at the Final Four, and actually when I called her to say, hey, I need to alert you, they may call you. And she was like, where? You know, but I will tell you, I wanted to make sure because I knew that, you know, it does matter. She did an unbelievable job here, and she taught me an awful lot in my career. I wouldn't be standing here in front of you if I didn't play for her. So I really appreciate the doors that she opened for me. I am grateful that I had the opportunity to play for her. A lot of us went into coaching that played for her because she inspired us. So I'm grateful for that. I'm still learning from her, and I hope we make her proud. Hello to you.
So, when you were interviewing for the job, obviously you're getting, you know, asked questions and stuff, but what questions did you have about Miami that were answered when you were applying for the job?
That's a great question. You know, I think the main thing for me was just about the team. You know, I wanted to know what was going on, you know, and what the state was. Was there any problems academically? Was there anything I needed to worry about that I was going to walk into that was kind of be blindsided by? And there wasn't. I was thrilled to find out that it was a great situation. And so, honestly, there was nothing that really caught me off guard. More, quite the opposite. I was more and more impressed the more I found out. Yeah.
I just want to ask you, with transfer portal and all the things that are going on, mm-hmm. Talk to players. I know some players, I think, were already in the portal. Is there mm-hmm. any chance they would come back? You know, where do you stand with the current roster?
That's a great question. And first, let me say this. When a coach of Katie's caliber and stature retires, after all the relationships that she's built, you can only imagine how young people, think back to how you felt when you were that age, how you would have felt in their situation. Those relationships were built over a long time. And I'm trying to do a, you know, really fast get to know you. And it takes time. So we're still working on that. I do feel that we've got a good chance to keep a lot of the kids that are here. But it's an ongoing process. And, you know, my hope is that they stay. Because I have told all of them I really want to coach them. I think there's a chance that there's one that's in the portal now that we can maybe get her back. I told her today that I absolutely love her game. And I love how she plays. And I would love to have her here because I think she's a difference maker. But I also want people to be 2 feet in. And it's awfully hard to build what we're trying to build if you're not 2 feet in. But I'm also trying to give them some space knowing that they just went through a gut-wrenching heart attack moment or heartache moment in losing somebody that they really cared about, even though I know she'll still be on campus and still help them in any way she can. So, you know, I'm not giving you a definitive answer because it's kind of in process, but I will tell you that that's why after I got back from the Final Four, I packed 2 bags and I'm here till school ends, and I could care less about the housing situation. The hotel's treating me great because building relationships with these players matters more to me than anything, and starting to get a grasp on recruiting. We've got visits set up already, and I want to get kids here, and I want to fill in the holes that we have regardless. Because I really think this is a special program, and there's a lot of kids who are very interested to be here, and that's been the fun part, is being on the phone and hearing the joy and the excitement in their voice. And I can't wait for the first official visit to have the opportunity to show all those things that we have.
Can I ask one follow-up? Yeah. Are any of your Toledo players maybe
planning
to follow
here? You know, no. Honestly, I spent a lot of time building that program, and when I parted with them, I wished them the very best. I asked them to give the new coach a chance, and I hope that they stay, simply because I think that is the best place for them. I love that team, and I will tell you that when I left that team, and my two assistants will tell you that was one of the hardest things I've done, because that's a 6-year relationship in some matters, you know, 2-3 years recruiting and then coaching them. And to have it dropped in their lap too, that, hey, I'm leaving, that's not easy. But they're great kids. They just made a great hire, and they'll be fine. and I will still be cheering for them from a distance. But the answer is no, and for good reason. I think they're in the place we recruited them to be, and I hope they stay there because I do think they have a chance to win their fourth championship in a row.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, and I'll say this. When I took over Toledo, I knew Mark Elin, the coach before. And so he and I went to dinner for 2 hours, and I said, tell me everything you think I need to know. And he gave me the cliff notes to help me, you know, not step in any potholes, to meet the people that I needed to meet, to avoid things that were going to take a lot of time, that were going to waste my time. And I told Katie when the dust settles, I want to do the same thing with her. I've also reached out to her 2 or 3 times just about things that I need to know. And even just to say, man, you did such an amazing job here. I want her to know that we will only ever speak extremely highly of her and her program, because how can you not? I mean, she did a tremendous job, and history books will show forever what an amazing job she did here. So I would be crazy not to lean on her and to try to gain as much advice as I can, but also her staff. And that's why I kept them on, because, you know, there's a lot to have. I jokingly call our staff the Brady Bunch. It is 2 families that are combined. And I do think the best of both worlds. And I'm so glad that they're here. But I will be, to answer your question, leaning on Katie from time to time. She retired for a reason. I don't want to be full-time asking her, but I will definitely reach out to her when we need it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. I think the nice thing to know is that when we go out to California, we'll play both teams and come home. If we had to do it in separate trips, it might be a little bit more daunting. But in non-conference, you're doing that. I think the big goal for our team is not to make too much of it. That's the hand we're dealt, so we need to roll up our sleeves and go to work. It's a daunting schedule anyway, because it's the ACC. I want our kids just to get ready for the challenge, and that starts now. It started this morning with lifting and workouts. You know, we get better now, and I don't want them to waste a second. There's 3 things that I look for with high school kids and even any recruit. And it starts with the first thing that catches anyone's eye is athleticism. Can they help us win our conference? And can they help us go deep in the tournament? If they can do that, that's the first thing. But that's not the only thing, and it's not the most important thing. That just might be the thing that catches your eye when you walk through the gym. The second thing is attitude. I watch the little things. So does my staff. And we write down, how do they treat their family? How do they treat their coach? How do they act when the game's not going well, when they miss 5 shots in a row? Are they still a good teammate then? Because you don't build great culture, which we're trying to build, without having kids that really care about each other and care more about their own individual stats. They care about the team and winning. And then the third thing is, academically, can they be successful? This is a great school, and I don't want to set a kid up for failure. And so, you know, if they hit those 3 things, then, and we need their position, then we're going to go after them with everything we have. But I think it's important to note, too, you know, do we fit what they want to? I don't want to waste time with a kid that's not interested in coming to Florida. I mean, who would do that? But, you know, if that's the case, we're not going to waste time.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry. Another question for you.
You're okay.
What do you think is, just based on everything you know a lot about the women's college basketball and everything, what do you think will be the biggest adjustment going from the MAC to the ACC, or from Toledo to Miami, Florida? Mm-hmm. For you, what do you think is
going to
be the biggest adjustment?
The housing market. Just jokingly. Yeah. That was eye-catching. No, in all honesty, and I told this to Dan when he asked me the same question, basketball is basketball. If it wasn't, Felicia Leggett-Jack, who came from our league, wouldn't have been ACC Coach of the Year this year. There's a lot of mid-major. More than half of the coaches in this league came from my level. Basketball is basketball. What the difference is what you have to sell and the caliber of athlete that you can sign. And so now I have more to sell. And now our staff, and that's why we retain some people, because they know the recruits that were being recruited. There's a relationship established there. We don't have to start from ground zero. But I think the important thing now is making sure that they know that we're here, they have our contact information, and that we aggressively go after them. Other than that, I'm very excited. We played a tough schedule. I'm not scared of, you know, we scrimmaged Notre Dame. We played Duke. We have played Virginia in the past. We were never scared to play anyone. So we're not going to be scared of anyone now. We just need to get ready because we're not just ready to play them. We want to beat them.
All right. Thank you, guys. If you have any more questions, we'll get those after. But we have a quick photo opportunity here.
All right. Great.
All right, here we go. Coach number 8. What's that, in front?
Right, here we go, yeah.
We're getting coached.
That's good.